have George and Gretchen Wintersteen with us, and they were very much a part of racing in the glory days, and also a part of the Simeone Museum because of their association with the Grand Sport that we have. Tell us how you guys met Fred Simeone, and something about your remembrances of him.
Well, the first I think I heard of Simeone I belonged to a rather casual group of people who called themselves the Clots. And you know what a clot is? A clot is somebody who goes very slowly in the right-hand lane in England. So he clots up the traffic. And these were old former race drivers and car owners and a couple of car dealers. And they would have regular meetings. And one time they said, well, let's all meet in at the Simeone's, Fred Simeone's garage in downtown Philadelphia. This is before he had the museum.
Yeah.
I couldn't make it. So that was my first knowledge of the name Simeone. Then long time passed. I had a heart issue down here in Aiken and went up to Pennsylvania to have the procedure done. And sometime after I recovered and got out of the hospital, I was sitting at my desk in Pennsylvania and the phone rang and I picked up the phone. The guy said, this is Mike Banbury. Do you remember who I am? And I said, yeah, you carved on me. Why? Did you forget something? And he said, no. I was taking my kids somewhere over Christmas time. And we went to the Simeone Foundation, which I really had never heard of. And your car is there. I said, what car? There's a Corvette Grand Sport there. I said, oh my God, I'd lost track of it because when I sold it for, I think, infamously $5,600, I'd totally lost track of it. We did encounter it at a Grand Sport reunion at Sebring. God knows what year that was, but I did see the guy I sold it to. And I said, look, if you ever want to sell the car, would you let me know? And he says, well, I've already turned down $1 million for it. And I said, well, geez, thanks anyway. But I immediately got on the phone after finding this out from the surgeon. And said, is Mr. Simeone available? And they said, well, sure, who are you? And I said, well, I'm George Wintersteen. I think I used to own that Grand Sport. And they said, oh my God, here, you know, put me right through. That was basically the first time I talked to him. He said, come on in, let's, you know, want to show you the car. And it went from there. And occasionally, obviously, on when they would exercise the Grand Sport, he'd ask me if I would drive it around the parking lot. It got to the point, I think, when I would drive it around the parking lot, he'd go up to the office and put his head in his hands because I tended to get my blood up a little bit. But
I remember one of the
started.
Yeah, you got into the car just like you were still in the USRRC.
Yeah,
you were cranking pretty good with the car.
Yeah, the only thing, the first time I did drive it, it was bouncing like you wouldn't believe it. I turned to Kevin and said, what kind of tire pressure seat you got? Oh, we got like 45 pounds in the rear tire. I said, holy Christ, racing is only supposed to be like 28 pounds, if that. And so they reduced the tire pressure and it was manageable then.
Yeah. Yeah, I'm sure he always agonized a little bit whenever anybody got into the cars like that. But
yeah,
well, thank you. Well, so tell us that you go back to I would say a second generation of Philadelphia racers. There was that first generation of Frank Griswold and Henry Wessels and guys. Yeah. That kind of started the road racing after the war. And you came on the scene about what, 1960 or so? Is that right?
Yeah, I went to a prep school in Newport, Rhode Island. And one of my classmates was a really nice guy. And he says, I've got an AC Bristol, and I've been running it in hill climbs in eastern Pennsylvania, Springtown, a whole bunch of them in eastern Pennsylvania. And he says, oh, yeah, I gather you just got a Porsche 1600 coupe. Let's go do some hill climbing. And I said, geez, that sounds like a lot of fun. And the only trouble was back then, you had to be 21 in order to drive competitively. Mm-hmm. He said, well, look, the way we do it is that you go to registration and they said, let's see your driver's license. And you say, well, you know, darn, I just misplaced my wallet the other day, but I went to AAA and they gave me a temporary license, which did not have a birth date on it. So I did that for about 3 years. Eventually I bought a Porsche RSK from Bob Holbert. In fact, I've just seen a picture of it. It used to belong to Pedro Rodriguez. He was the one that bought it from the factory.
Wow.
Just seen a picture of it. And so I ran first off the little Porsche and then the RSK. And eventually, I think I was up for the championship that year. And this one chap said, Wintersteen, I don't understand why I never see you at local motor races like Vineland. And I said, well, yeah, we're just testing and things like that. So I didn't show up for the award ceremony because I knew the jig was cooked, so to speak. But by that time, I had turned 21 and went on from there.
Now, you raced the Porsche and then you moved into real sports racers, like you had an Elva. And some other interesting cars. Was that in the USRRC or were you still racing SCCA at that time?
Sort of the earliest picture I have is of the Elva Porsche at Augusta, at the Augusta Raceway, which I think you sent me a link on.
Okay.
And I've got a picture of me in it on the starting grid. Then I raced that, I think, went to Pensacola. There was a race at Pensacola, whether it was USRRC or what, I don't know. I don't know when the USRRC was originally, you know, formally organized, but I raced it there. And then I, you know, sort of knew Roger Penske, and he said, look, I've got a slightly better car than this. Would you be interested in buying my Cooper Chevy? And I said, sure. And this was a Cooper Chevy, and I bought it from him and raced it for about a year, I guess, and then sort of went one after another, a whole bunch of cars, it seems.
Yeah, you bring up the name of Roger Penske, again, a contemporary of yours, and also started in hill climbs. How did you come to meet Roger? Because you had more than a slight association with him going forward.
Yeah, well, we would, as I say, this friend of mine and I would rent the Vineland racetrack to go and, you know, hair around at the Vineland Raceway. But we never obviously did any races. And Roger, a couple times, was there testing the Xerox Special.
Ah.
And, you know, since he lived in Gladwin, probably about 5 miles away from where I was living, we just got to know each other, I guess.
And tell me now, you had a shop over in Newtown Square.
Yeah.
And was that, did you, you and Roger used part of that shop, is that correct, for the original Penske Racing? Or how did that all come about?
Well, the real scenario was that the cars that I was racing at the time, including the Grand Sport Coupe, were being managed by a chap, by another person. And for some reason, I can't remember exactly why, this friend of mine, Peter Getz, and I removed our cars from him. And I was in the need of a race shop. And I called Roger and he said, sure, I'm not using the bay at Newtown Square. I said, well, could I rent it from you? And he said, sure. So we moved our cars down there, got the Grand Sport ready for Sebring in 65. And more or less went from there. But it was the funny thing about that race shop is that the adjacent, the next door shop in this little shop, tiny shopping center, was a clockmaker. Mr. Heine, I think was his name. And what he did, he'd go around the main line of Philadelphia winding people's clocks. So he would have, he must have had, you know, 30 wall clocks in his shop. And they'd go bing, bong, bong. They'd sound out the hour, usually simultaneously. But then when we would have to fire up the engine, he'd come and pound on the door and say, can't you turn that damn thing off? It's getting all the clocks are going crazy.
You say the Grand Sport Coupe, because 002, which was the car at the Simeone, of course, is a roadster. Yeah. You've had more than one Grand Sport in your lifetime?
Yeah, I had chassis number 5, which was the last car that Roger raced in down at Nassau at the Speedweeks.
Yeah.
I had taken the Cooper down there to race in it. I think the Cooper probably had a Formula V also. And for some reason, we could never get the Cooper going. And Roger said, here, you know, would you and Peter Goetz, who is my best friend, would you want to buy the Grand Sport? And we agreed on it. And I raced it down at the Nassau Speedweeks. And so that's how we came to own the chassis number 5.
Now, had that been part of the Mecum racing team, the chassis number 5?
I know it was white. So it was a car that both that Roger shared with Jim Hall in some race.
Yeah. Huh. Interesting. And so tell us then, how did you come to get 002, the Roadster?
Okay, well, let's see. That was 65 at Sebring, which is the year of the flood, right?
Yeah.
And then I can't remember what I had that during that year. Probably, I think I had a Brabham, little Formula B Brabham that I raised single seaters. And what was it? Okay, that's when Roger in 66, he had the production Corvette.
Mm-hmm.
And then he also got from Duntoff, he got chassis number 1, which is the first Roadster.
Right.
And they raced it. We raced it at Sebring. I co-drove the coupe with Ben Moore. Actually, backing up a bit, the first race for it was at the Daytona 24 Hour.
Right.
And I infamously got tangled up with a crash during the middle of the night and took the front end off, which I'm sure you've seen the pictures of the car with no front end.
Yes. And a flashlight for a headlight. Yes.
Yeah. Well, yeah, because I came in and Roger sent me right to bed. So go get some sleep. And he sent Dick Goldstrand out. So there was Goldstrand, Ben Moore, and myself. Dick Goldstrand out, and of course, you got black flagged immediately for having no headlights. I don't know how many laps Goldstrand made, but he would just follow another car. Well, so they got black flagged, and Roger taped some flashlights onto the fenders, and that met the rules.
Right.
And so that was Daytona. And then we finally got the car fixed up, ran it at Sebring, and finished, I think, 9th. Which was at the time, I think, the highest finishing Corvette ever.
Yeah, and won your class in both races, right?
Yeah,
you won your class at Daytona too.
Somehow, so, God knows how. I mean, I missed most of the excitement, which included going. Roger and the crew went, found some guy with a Corvette, and I don't know, unbeknownst to him, I think they took the radiator out of it and put it in the race car. And so I woke up and said, you mean I'm supposed to go out in that damn thing? And they said, sure, yeah, here we go. So we somehow, I don't know how, but somehow we did win our class.
Oh, boy. Those are now. That was Roger's first race for Penske Racing at Daytona in 1966. And, you know, everyone knows, or most people know, that Roger had been a pretty fair driver up until that point. How did he react, do you think, to not driving and being in the pits managing? What did you get an impression that he was, you know, sorry to not be in the driver's seat?
I never got. Did you ever get an impression that Roger missed the race?
No. He was at that point. He was looking at the dealership in Philadelphia, and was far more interested. And somebody approached him about Indianapolis, I remember, and he said, "No, you ought to talk to this young guy, Mario Andretti." Funny. Yeah. But no, Roger, Mark Donahue definitely suffered from not driving, and then of course he went back to driving, which was not a good idea. But Roger was all business, like he just as he's always been.
Mm-hmm. Interesting. Now, you said that you bought your Porsche originally from Bob Holbert, and your mechanic that you had, Bill mm-hmm. Murphy, had a long association with Holbert. Tell us about Murph. You know, his name is on the side of the Grand Sport, and you hear his name occasionally, but I don't see a whole lot written about him.
It was Bill Mayberry was his name.
Bill Mayberry. Yeah,
he was a mechanic at Holbert's in Warrington, Holbert's dealership in Warrington, and I guess during the conversation with Bob about buying the RSK, I said, I'm in need of a mechanic. And he said, well, I think Murph would be willing to come work for you full time. And so that's where it started. And that was probably 65, I guess. '65, we had sort of two journeyman guys who got the Grand Sport going. And then I guess it was 66 was really when Murph started full time for me. There's Bill Mayberry, Murph, and then Bill Scott, who was a machinist basically for Sun Oil Company.
Yeah.
So Sun Oil had a sort of a machine shop where they developed the special gas pumps, you know, that would mix the high test and the low test and all that. And it was right about a mile away from in Newtown Square. And when anything would ever be needed for the race car, Scotty would go off to the machine shop, make it up, and bring it back.
Wow. So Scotty actually worked for you before he went to work doing stuff for Roger. Is that correct?
I never really worked for either of us.
Oh, but I mean, I was associated with Roger later on, but he was actually first associated with you.
Well, yeah, I think it was Scotty and Axel, Roy Gain, were involved with creating the Xerox Special.
Right.
Scotty was sort of just a journeyman. I mean, he did our engines, the engines for me. And I said, you know, what's going to cost, Scotty? Now just take me down to Sebring with you. He was
really.
Yeah.
Oh, that's really cool. Now, and then another, did you have any association with Mullen Body Shop? Did they do your paint work for you like they did for Penske?
I don't think so, no. No, I don't recall that. I knew
Larry Schmarsh
and all those guys, but I don't recall that they did any specific body work for us. There was another chap in Newtown Square who did sort of the body work when they had to, we the Grand Sport Coupe, I took the front end of that off at Nassau. So we got a front end from Nikki Chevrolet for some reason. And we grafted that onto the what was left of the coupe. I don't know if the coupe owner really knows that at this point, but it was a bogus front end.
Yeah.
And I think it was a local guy in Newtown Square who did the patched it together.
Well, now, 001 and 002, Roger bought both of those together and then sold you 002, or how did that come about? Because they were the same time, right?
That's about the same time. I mean, the 001 showed up at Sebring, obviously. And after Sebring, Roger said, you know, I think I can get the mate to this car out of General Motors. Would you be interested in it? And I said, hell yes. And so I can remember driving out to Dearborn and or to Warren, Michigan, I guess it is. And, yeah. And Roger said, you know, just go and ask for Zora Duntoff. And so I got the message through to Duntoff that I was coming to pick up the Grand Sport. And Duntoff said, oh, come with me. I will show you some interesting things. And he took me into this warehouse and sort of every lump in the warehouse, he would pull the cover back off. And one of them I distinctly remember was a four overhead cam V8. I mean, it was the most unbelievable looking engine. And so, I picked it up on the trailer did home.
And I mean, it gave him a check for the money and he gave you how did that come about?
I wish I could find the canceled check. I think I probably paid Roger for it.
Oh.
Went through him. Yeah.
Yeah. All right. And do you remember at all how much you paid for it?
Somehow $3,000 sounds right.
Oh God. Yeah. Now what possessed you to buy that car? I mean, even by this is what 1966, right? When you yes. bought it.
Yeah.
So, you know, by, and then you wanted to race it in the USRRC.
Yeah.
And you must have been just about at that point the only front engine car in the USRRC. Would that be correct?
Well, there's some Cobras. Skip Scott had a Cobra, 427 Cobra, big engine Cobra. So he had that. I'm sure there were a bunch of other front engine cars, but the Grand Sport was obviously a dinosaur.
Yeah.
And if I'd had it the year before, I think it would have done even better.
Yeah.
Because the rear engine English Anglo-American hybrids were pretty grotty back then. And then they were starting to get developed in 66.
Yeah. And now, did it already have the 427 Traco engine in it when you got it? Or is that something that was done after you bought it?
Just like chassis number one, it had probably a 327 or you know, slightly
bored. 377 is what they should have had.
Yeah, 377.
Yeah.
This one had it, and I believe it probably was an aluminum block.
Mm-hmm.
But the way to go, I'd had some rough luck with sort of the precursor to the Can-Am cars. I had the Rogers Cooper, which was a very, very good car, really, really did very well with that. And then I got invited to, me and Walt Hanskin were invited to come over and race at Brands Hatch. And I said, well, God, if I'm going to be racing at Brands Hatch, I'm going to get a new car. So I bought a McLaren Mark I, which is an utter disaster.
Mm.
And so I was kind of, I needed something reliable that would be, you know, fun to drive and all that. And the Grand Sport seemed to fit the ticket. So we took whatever engine was in it, and learning from the adaptation that had to be made to 001, I think we had to take a section out of the front cross member so that the engine would fit in, and just put in a Traco with a four barrel carburetor.
And who did Murph did that, or who actually did that?
Yeah, Murph, Scotty, and I, put that. And of course, the 001 had 58 millimeter side drafts, which were quite impressive.
Yeah. And how was it to drive that car? And you raced it that year in 66. How did you do? And how was it to drive?
Oh, it was more fun you can imagine. I mean, it had a locked rear end, so pushing it around the pits was rather rather difficult. But I think there's a famous quote from A.J. Foyt when, I guess, 001 went past him on the straight at Sebring. He says, what the F is that thing? Because, of course, its aerodynamics were not terribly good. I mean, it looked like a speedboat.
Right.
Actually, when I had the coupe, in the year of the flood, needless to say, the car was, during the rain, MGs would pass us because of the wide tires.
Yeah.
And I could turn it, you know, at the end of the straight, I could turn the wheel from lock to lock and nothing would happen. I mean, it was that, you know, that bad aerodynamically. But the thing that was great in the USRC was it was so bloody wide that nobody could really get by.
Interesting. Now, and you only owned the car then, or raced it in 66. Did you sell it then right after the 66 season, or how long did you keep it for?
Well, I needed the money for next year's car. You know, I wanted something a little bit better. So I ran an ad, the famous ad in Auto Week.
Yeah.
And the guy rang up and said, you know, I'll give you what you're asking for. And I said, you know, he said, would you deliver it to me? I said, sure, somewhere down in Georgia. So I took it down, trailered it down to Georgia. And the guy said, oh, yeah, here it is. It looks great. Terrific. You want to stay for dinner? I said, no, I really got to get back. I didn't. I was worried that he was going to change his mind.
And
so with that money, I managed. I think that's when I started to go into single seaters.
Yeah. And you had quite a career in single seaters. I mean, I was reading, you know, about your, I guess it was the 68 season when you had the Eagle.
So you
went out and bought one of the first Formula 5000 Formula A Eagles that All-American racers made. Tell us about that and your experience with Dan Gurney.
Well, I think somehow I heard that Dan Gurney was building a Formula 5000 car, and I rang him up and he says, yeah, for sure. You know, here's what it would cost. And I'll make it up for you. And I said, well, geez, you know, the first race of the season is at, where was it? Continental Divide. And I kept calling him, is the car ready? Is the car ready? Oh, no. I'm afraid it's not going to be ready for that race. So I missed the first race of the season. The second race of the season was at New Mansfield, Oklahoma, Warbonnet Park.
Yeah.
And it was New Mansfield because the old Mansfield was under a dam somewhere. And unfortunately, during the course of the race, Lou Sell had the other one. During the course of the race, the radiator pipe, the hot water pipe to the radiator, was right next to the accelerator pedal.
Oh boy!
And I said, geez, it's getting kind of warm down here, and you know, but I kept going with it. I think, you know, obviously finished second. And what I did is I did a deep burn on my right foot, so I had to miss the third race this season. I talked to Roger. I think the third race was at Elkhart. And I talked to Roger, said, hey, you know, Roger, could you get Mark to drive? I asked Mark, and he said, well, you better ask the captain. And Roger said, no, I don't think so. I wanted, you know, just to deny Sell, you know, those points. So I think of the eight races, I missed two. And still it came down to the wire at Laguna Seca that I had to win and Lou Sell had to pick up no points. So unfortunately, that's not the way it ended.
Yeah. And then the next year, then you moved on from the Eagle. Is that correct? And
to the Lola.
Yeah.
Which was, needless to say, somewhat primitive as a tube frame car and things like that. But in retrospect, thank God it was, because of the classic St. Javit thing.
Yeah.
So that put me out of the last race of the year at Sebring. And then that's when I got them. As I was recovering from that crash, we were up in St. Javit at the, Siebken Resort. No, wait, that's Elkhart.
That's Elkhart. Yeah.
Yeah. No, we were at a very fancy hotel and having dinner, and I started to go up, you know, say, I don't feel so good. So I started going upstairs, and Carl Hogan perceived that I was not quite right. And as I was going up the stairs, I started to keel over backwards. And thank God Carl caught me.
Yeah.
But during the course of that dinner, we'd gotten to know Dickie Smothers through the racing and came up with the idea, how about combining forces? And we found a guy that said he would go hunt up some money for a percentage. And so that's where the Lotus, the 1970 season started.
Yeah. How was the Lotus? You and Dickie had matching Lotus 70s. How was that as a car?
It was a Lotus.
Yeah. Okay. Elaborate, please.
My forte had been reliability.
Yeah.
And Lotuses were not known for that.
Yeah.
And so we had numerous failures, mostly structural, where they, you know, the front suspension cost me winning the Sears Point race. They butt welded the suspension pieces rather than doing an overlap, and the front end, one of the front suspensions broke, and we had other than it. Then I think at Sebring, the final race of the year, after practice, we looked at the car and it was about to break in half. And I said, oh, God. So I went out and I think I did two laps and then came in.
Mm-hmm.
That of course, Sebring is notorious, but the Lotus was certainly not built for Sebring.
Yeah, yeah. Mm-hmm. So how was Dick to team with? I mean, I remember, one of the first races I think he ever did professionally was Sebring in 69, and he won his class there. And then he came back in 71 and driving a John Greenwood Corvette with John, and they won their class. He seemed to be a pretty good driver.
He was no slouch. I mean, the Laguna Seca or Monterey race that we're in, I mean, I can't remember who won. I think can't remember who won that race, but I was second and Dick was third. So I mean, he was a good racer.
Yeah, yeah. So now, Gretchen, tell us, all this time, George is out there having fun on the racetrack. What were you doing? Were you in there, crossing your fingers and hoping everything was going to turn out all right?
Oh, aren't you? No, not really, actually. It was always an interesting time, and it was mostly timing and scoring. And of course, it was rather primitive in those days because everything was a Hoyer stopwatch and nothing digital.
Right.
And some tracks like Elkhart were wonderful because you could get brats and corn. And some ones like Warbonnet Park, you hope you never see again. And I don't think they ever raced there again. I'm not sure.
Yeah.
But it was not good. But on the whole, Murph was a wonderful character. And he always said, we're like the circus that set up our camp, our tents in another place the next week, because all the same racers would be there, all the same mechanics. So it was like a huge traveling tribe, and it was great fun. And Dick and Tom were just enchanting to be with. Although there were a lot of smothers, and they all would appear for dinner, especially in California. And they really were Californians. And so that was, I'm talking about 14, 15 people.
I had no idea.
Yeah, a huge family, absolutely all of them charming.
Yeah.
Tommy was very, very supportive of the racing, and that was nice. And he was quite amusing to spend time with.
Yeah. And now you say timing and scoring. I assume then you and Judy Stropas had a relationship, did he help you with timing and scoring at all?
No, not really, because she was working for Roger and other teams. I'm trying to think. The first time, as I told Fred, I went to Indy, and Judy and I timed Indy the next year for Mark. But she's a dear friend. I mean, we just see her every chance we can. She's quite an extraordinary influence in motor racing.
Yes, she is. Yes, she is.
She's very involved with Simeone, I'm glad to see.
Yes. Yeah. We see her quite a bit and, you know, very fortunate to have her helping, you know, on a number of the events that are there at the museum. But yeah, one wonderful person. Now, another aspect of, you know, some of the lore of that era is the Cannonball Baker Seat of Shining Seat Memorial Trophy Day, which to use its official full name.
Absolutely.
And I understand the two of you were involved in what may have been the origins of that concept. Tell us about that.
Well, I want to know who told you that because it's interesting. I was working for Roger, timing and scoring for the race at Pocono. And there were a number of Formula 5000 people involved. And they said they were so sick to death of all the rules. All these, because USAC had, back then it was called USAC, had all these rules and everything. And so since Mario, all the Andretti's are from that area, somehow we all ended up back at Mario's cabin in the woods with a fair amount of gin and tonics and made up this race that said you, the only thing you could not do is put your car on a plane or a train. And other than that, there were no rules. And it came to be, which is, I think, pretty hysterical.
Yeah.
And they got away with it until Brock Yates wrote the article for Playboy, and then the cops clamped down on them. But that you could write a whole book on.
Yeah.
In fact, Amelia Island did a special on the Cannonball race.
Yeah.
I think.
Yeah.
I'm sorry we missed it, but it was just one of racing's better jokes.
Yeah. No, I remember reading about it in the, you know, in the pages of Car and Driver, and wishing I could be part of it, but it, little just never was able to.
Well, I don't know.
some of the legends, of course, there was the PRDA, the Polish Racing Drivers Association, thanks to Oscar Kowalewski. Well,
yeah,
I think Judy Stropas. Who else?
Judy wanted me to drive it with her.
But Judy Stropas and a bunch of other people got rented a Chevy van.
No, that was the PRDA. That was the Polish Racing Drivers.
PRDA. That was Polish Racing Drivers. Well, they got a Chevy van and they filled it with 55-gallon barrels of gasoline so they would never have to stop. But of course, had there been an accident, it would have been.
Oh, God, oh my. Don't even want to think about it.
And Brock Yates and Dan Gurney made it to California in, like, I want to say like 28 hours, or it was amazing. And he got stopped for speeding, and all the policeman did was ask for Dan's autograph.
Just keep going. Who do you think you are, Dan Gurney?
He had his priorities straight.
Oh, God. Well, yeah, I mean, speaking of that car, that, of course, was owned by Kirk F. White, who was, again, another Philadelphia mainliner. Did you have any connection at all with Kirk White in your years of racing?
I worked for him after I gave up racing, but I think that's as much as I'll say. I'll put it that way.
That's his goal. I don't know where he is.
You know Phil Tegmeyer then, I assume.
Oh, yeah.
Okay. Yeah. All right. Well, thank you so much. Is there anything I haven't covered here? Anything you'd like to share, you know, for the history of anything that was, you know, especially interesting or funny or significant?
Well, I mean, the funny aspect, of course, needless to say, was the 1970 season with the Smothers Brothers. And whether it was cryptic or my imagination, I don't know. But Dickie and I would come in after, you know, during practice and say, how are we doing? And that was, you know, with, as Gretchen said, you know, sort of stopwatches and a piece of paper. And I'd say, you know, we'd sort of say, well, God, let me look at that lap time sheet. And I'd look at it and I say, it's not raining. Why is the ink running? Well, obviously they were laughing so hard with tears. whether that's true or not, I don't know. But I mean, the Smothers Brothers was absolutely fascinating. Needless to say, the safety aspects during that season, I never could figure out. I was always leery of any racetrack that had guardrails too close to the track. I said, geez, I don't want to, you know, I'd rather go off and spin out in the grass. Well, of course, you don't think that beyond the grass are trees.
Yeah.
So it was rather dangerous. And needless to say, the Saint-Gervais race was a classic. When I looked at the starting grid on it, I know exactly what happened is that a friend of mine inadvertently moved over on me, and they had curbs around the track. And at the crest of the hill, I hit the inside curb, and that, of course, launched the car up in the air. But the danger was significant, and certainly 68 was not a good year in Indy.
Yeah.
Nowadays, they are so safe, but frankly, they're so boring because with all the aerodynamics, you can't follow. And my argument, which I've talked to, you know, at Penske's 50th celebration, I talked to the Unsers and all that. And I said, look, you know, it's not how fast you go. It's how much faster you go than the next guy. And one of the most exciting races I think I ever watched was down at the SCCA runoffs at Daytona. And it was a Formula V race. Huh. And they were not going very fast, but boy, I'll tell you, they were dicing back and forth. And one of the most fun races I ever had, I think, was down at Nassau. I took a Formula V down there, and Chuck Parsons and I had a real ding-dong battle somewhere down the line because the Europeans had hotter Formula Vs. And in that, I remember coming in after the race, and Gretchen said, oh, God, you really had a good race. So there was this guy that showed up in the pits, and he says, is that your husband out there? And Gretchen said, yeah. And I said, they're really having a good time, aren't they? And I said, yeah, well, who was that guy? Oh, yeah. She said, I don't know. Oh, there he goes now. That was A.J. Foyt.
But he did love the Formula V race, which was very interesting. Yeah. And yeah. I think that's what made so much of it fun, and so much has changed. I still have the letter with my badge number on it that says, and even though I am, it doesn't really say even though I'm female, but it does say allow this person in.
Uh-huh.
And the whole attitude has changed quite a bit for racing.
And now, when you say that, you mean that was a letter for Indy, is that right?
Because women were not allowed in the pit.
Weren't allowed. Yeah, I think Judy Stropas has told me a very similar story.
Yeah, she and I both, we had to carry girl letters, they were called.
Yeah.
And but, I mean, Roger's got Indy now. Hey, everything's good. And a closing is just to say how proud we are of Roger. I mean, his last weekend was just amazing.
Yeah.
And what a force he's been, and how incredibly gracious to everybody that ever helped him or raced for him. I mean, he's a very, very unusual person.
He is.
I sure hope continued success. I don't know how he can get much more successful.
Well, the Porsches could start really dominating, you know, in WEC and in IMSA. And that's only a matter of time, I guarantee you. You know, they're not. I was down at Sebring this year. And boy, I tell you, that is a incredible car. And they should have won the race. You know, it was really a shame what happened. At the race. They should have come in 1 and 2. But, you know, they'll come back.
Yeah, for sure.
Well, it'll be wonderful to watch, but I don't think there isn't. I mean, he's got some like off-road racers in Australia, even. I mean, he's into everything. It's just extraordinary. And he's successful, and he's organized, and I don't deal with him on a business standpoint, but as far as I can see, he's one of the kindest people out there.
Well, responsible is not the word. You know, when you think of acquiring the Indianapolis Motor Speedway, I mean, it's more of being like a custodian of a significant historical object than, you know, just buying a racetrack. And then to have COVID hit right after that. And, you know, if it had been almost anybody other than Roger, I wonder if the Indy 500 would even still be around, you know, because a real quote businessman would have cut their losses and just said, oh, we're going to sell off the assets and I'll get out.
He is a true person who has given back to his sport.
Yeah.
Real
passion.
And that's the best you can say about anybody, I think, that's been involved. But he's done a yeoman's work for racing.
Yeah.
And so I wish him even more success.
I think most people do, thankfully. Well, thank you guys both. And love to see you when you come back up in September. Please let me know when, and we'll meet over at the museum.
Super.
So, thank you.
Okie doke. Thanks, Eric.